next topic, I think, is something that is tied directly to the achievement gap. Many experts say that, and a lot of research confirms that there are social, emotional, and academic benefits for students of color who have teachers of color. However, currently, a child's chance of having a Latino teacher during his or her K-12 experience is 1 in 50. The professional pipeline from recruitment, induction, and retention for teachers of color needs to be strengthened. The percentage of Hispanic students swelled from 18% in 2002 to 24% in 2012. And within 20 years, more than a third of America's public school children will likely be Hispanic. The fact remains that more than half of Latinos drop out of high school, and far too few go on to and graduate from college. This has tremendous implications for the social and economic opportunities, not only for the Latino community, but also for the nation and the country. And I thought that's why we would talk about diverse teachers, important to have, hard to get. That's our next panel, and I want to introduce our panelists. Elliot Brueggemann. Elliot, why don't you come on up here? A Deputy Education Officer at Minnesota Public Schools. Ambar Hansen, a Director of Community Engagement, Hiawatha Academies. Ambar, welcome. Don Samuels, Minneapolis Board of Education. Don. I saw Don, okay. And Cecilia Stanton Adams, the Director of Enterprise Diversity and Talent Acquisition at Buffalo Wild Wings. Hello, Cecilia. Well, thank you. And I think one of the things that we want to start out with, and I believe that Elia, how is that? Karen, can you get that, Rob? You okay? Maybe we have to get in the middle of the staging. A stage of people out on strike, you know, they're outside. Okay, here we go. But I think we want to start with Elia. Well, why don't we do this? Here's the microphone. Why don't you guys each give a one minute information
about you and what you do at
All right, now that I'm sitting steadily. My name is Ambar Hansen, and I'm the Senior Director of Community Engagement at Hiawatha Academies. Hiawatha Academies is a network of free, public, high-performing charter schools in South Minneapolis, and our mission is to empower scholars with the knowledge, character, and leadership skills to graduate from college and serve the common good. And in my role, I oversee all of our external relations work, so our family engagement work, our admissions and enrollment, our talent recruitment, marketing component, and our community collaborations.
Hi, I'm Don Samuels. I'm director of the school board at Minneapolis Public Schools.
Well, it's going to be the 3.0.
Okay. I'm also CEO of MicroGrants, one organization that gives grants to low-income folks going into business or going into work and to address their specific startup needs. And I've been on this school board since January of 2015. Prior to that, I ran for mayor and with a very intense education platform. So all of my supporters kind of came at me after I lost the race and urging me to run for the school board. So I've been there for a year and a half. And now, of course, you know we have a new superintendent. We just had a two-day retreat to get to know each other and to strategize the future, address some of the kind of issues and concerns that you would have.
Earlier in my youth, I would come and I am working right now for Minneapolis Public School. I'm the deputy education officer. Prior to Minneapolis Public School, though, I have been in education for over 33 years. I taught K-12 in Southern Minnesota, Spanish business and EL. I was also a principal in SUPI in Minnesota. I was the director of Shadrach St. Mary's for 4 years. I taught at the university, at Minnesota State University. I trained aspiring principals. And I have to say, during the 3 years that I had this position, I only saw one Latino go through their program, which is too sad to say. I was assistant commissioner of education prior to coming to Minneapolis for 4 years. And I'm glad to be at Minneapolis. There is some challenges, I know that. But I know we're going to conquer them because we are working hard.
Hello, I'm Cecilia Stanton Adams. I'm currently serving as the Director of Enterprise Talent Acquisition and Diversity and Inclusion at Buffalo Wild Wings. I'm also the CEO of Stanton Adams Learning Institute, which works to help build professional development skills for those in the Twin Cities. And prior to that, I worked over 10 years in college and university systems, particularly looking to build diversity strategies from a holistic perspective and ensure that we have students entering college and being able to graduate. This is a really important topic for me, not only for the work that I do, but I'm also a parent of a 21-year-old who will be completing her education at the University of Minnesota. I'm a first-generation college student, as well as, both of my parents are from Honduras and also have their own experiences coming into the United States before English as a second language was even a part of our public school systems. So there's a lot of great things that I'd like to share today in terms of personal experiences as well as institutional and systemic issues we need to look at in terms of the diversity recruitment of our teachers.
Well, good. Well, that's our panel here. I understand, Elia, I understand you have a few video that we could look at and recall.
Yes, and actually, you should tell about the video. There are four different pipelines into education right now in Minneapolis Public Schools that we are working with, and one is for our students. And one I am very much involved is with our Latino students. When I go and talk to students about going to education, especially our English learners, I tell them, use your language. Become a Spanish teacher. You can clap up all those tests. That's what I did. That's how I went into education. When I came to this country, actually, I was studying law in Mexico. And when I came here, I thought, well, I'm going to use my language because I really didn't know much English. So I went into Mankato and I became the Spanish teacher and I clapped all my tests, all my grammar. So I'm telling the students, we need to prepare you for that. One of the clip videos that you are going to see is where we put in at Wellston High School, we have 40% Latinos, AP Spanish for them. And at first I was told, no, they already know Spanish. That doesn't matter. Remember, the AP is a college course and is accepted worldwide. It's like an AP English. You must know your grammar. So this is really helping the students. If those kids have tested for the AP test with a 4 and a 5. 5 is the highest you can get. So that's excellent. The other video you are going to see is about our bilingual certificates that we are giving according to the LEAPS Act that the legislature passed in 2014. So we graduated those students by giving them the ACFL test or an AP Spanish test and then getting college credit just by using the language. So let's see the video clips.
Ha sido un challenge. Honestamente, ha sido muy fuerte para mí para poder aprender mi idioma nuevo y empezar a aprender todas las reglas que se necesita saber en el inglés, la gramática, cuando está escribiendo un ensayo, lo que debe hacer, lo que no debe hacer. Y pues me siento que me ha ayudado demasiado.
¿Qué ha sido lo mejor que te puedes llevar de este curso? Fue la experiencia de haber experimentado con los profesores, con la gente que te ayudó a entender mejor este lenguaje. ¿Qué es lo que te llevas tú?
Lo que me llevo yo es lo que me han enseñado. De todos los trabajos y todos los ensayos que hice, pues eso lo voy a mantener para mí. Y si en algún futuro, cuando se escriben otro ensayo, tienen Spanish, podré mirar atrás y podré tomar ejemplos de cosas que debo hacer y no debo.
Bien, y ahora nos encontramos con Samantha, otra de las estudiantes también beneficiadas por este programa tan importante en donde se vaya pues se lleva a cabo una ceremonia de premiación, de reconocimiento a más de 200 estudiantes aquí. ¿Cómo te sientes? ¿Qué es lo que has experimentado ser parte de este nuevo programa de poder tener dos idiomas?
Estoy muy feliz de tener la oportunidad de recibir este certificado. Es de verdad un honor grandísimo que me reconozcan el hecho de ser bilingüe. De verdad me hace muy feliz.
Me encuentro con Fanny, una de las estudiantes reconocidas el día de hoy por el programa bilingüe. Fanny, ¿qué ha sido para ti estar cursando estas clases de segundo idioma?
Bueno, me siento muy agradecida con el Minneapolis Public School, especialmente con Wilson, que me ha apoyado de tener el sello de bilingüismo. Y es una ventaja tan grande para mí, aunque mi madre me ha enseñado desde pequeña a hablar y ahora tengo esa habilidad y es como un talento que voy a recibir el sello de bilingüismo. Y me siento muy contenta porque no todos tienen esa oportunidad de tener el sello de bilingüismo tan así como rápido cuando pasa.
Yeah, that's it. And again, it's about students seeing the language as an asset. And I think that that's how we're going to get them into the teaching profession. If they are ELs, take advantage of your language and become a Spanish teacher, and then you will then branch into other areas of education.
Well, this crisis here of not having diverse teachers, it's been well documented. It's everywhere in the country. You know, years ago, Latinos were situated in 7 states. That was the bulk of the Latino community, Texas, California, Florida, Illinois. But that's no longer the case. The South is having an explosion, the Carolina explosion of Latinos. Omaha, Nebraska, over 150,000 Latinos in the last 10 years. So schools are being overwhelmed, and yet diverse teachers, maybe 3% of the total teachers in the country are diverse. So let me start out with this question. I know years ago, corporations always had the issue of trying to recruit a diverse workforce, and Minnesota was one of the last choices. Now, why don't each of you, we'll start with you, Cecilia, explain. Is it Minnesota? Is it our way of life here, or is it the weather? What is it? But also talk about the teachers and what do you see as one of the roadblocks and why we haven't been able to attract the talented teachers here?
Yeah. So you know, I am originally from New York City, where you know we have a very diverse population, although you know still very segregated there. You know, people's nationality was really important. And so, you know, being Honduranian, there are lots of Honduranians out in New York. Coming to Minnesota, while we have a Latino population, you say, you know, how many Honduranians in this room?
Zero.
One, yay, awesome. Thank you. But that's pretty much what it is, right? You don't find many people that are like you in terms of having the same cultural values. And even like I remember coming here 10 years ago and products to get your hair done or to make the kind of dishes and foods that you like to eat. It was really hard to get people to come to Minnesota. And I remember when I first moved here, I called home and my mom's like, what are you doing out there? There are no Latinos out there. People don't go to Minnesota. And I think that was really you know, some of the thinking that just it really wasn't a place that was welcoming and inclusive. To not only Latinos, but people of color in general. That has changed drastically in the past 10 years. And we're seeing multicultural communities continue to grow and grow at all levels of the socioeconomic status. But the challenge that we have now is not just recruiting people into different industries, whether it be corporate or education, but creating that place of inclusion. Right, so you can live in Minnesota and feel like you can get a job, but do you want to stay there? Do you want to feel like you're one of just a few people or a handful of people in your organization? Do you want to work really hard in your career to end up walking into a boardroom and being the only person of color, and not only being an expert in your field, but being looked to be the expert of your race? That's still a huge challenge, and I think it's something that we're seeing in corporate because it's something that has really come through the school systems. I asked my daughter when she was probably about 15 years old, have you had any teachers of color? And she was like, no, but I remember a black janitor in one of my schools. And that was very startling to me, because the strongest Latina teacher that she had in her life was me. And I think that's another important thing to remember is, you know, we don't have that diversity of teachers that we really need, or diversity in corporate America, but it's really important for us to surround our children with the diversity, no matter where it comes from, because we can't always rely on the school systems to have that experience for them. So that's kind of my two cents.
Well, I echo what, you know, Celia had said, but at Minneapolis Public School right now, we have four areas where we are actually are growing up on teachers. One is the bilingual pathway, and this is a partnership with the University of Mankato, where our associate educators are going to be able to get their, finish their bachelor's degree. So Mankato is looking at our employees who are associate educators who already either have a bachelor's degree in another area, or they have their associate degree, so to complete into a bilingual pathway. So the survey that we have done, most of those associate educators want to either become an elementary teacher, they want to become a Spanish teacher, or an English as a second language teacher. The other one is the Grow Your Own that we do have where we with the University of Minnesota. And this pathway, they all must have already their bachelor's degree, and it's most for elementary education, and usually in the content areas. The other that we have is Remember State. It's also something new that we are starting, and that's the Emerging Educators Program, where again, we are looking at growing teachers of color. And then I mentioned about the students. So those are the four areas. And I have to say that we're very grateful to the school board, because the school board we allocated some funding to give to those teachers as a way of a scholarship with the University of Mankato and also with the University of Minnesota. And we're looking at Metro State. So that is very important for us. And there is no question that our children must have teachers who look like them, you know, in our school. Another area that we are working with is actually with Mexico and with Spain. The Department of Education has 25 visas where we can bring educators from other countries. So we are able to bring teachers from Spain and also teachers from Mexico. However, I do believe that we have the talent right here in Minnesota, and we have, you know, within the Latino community, many that have that degree in other countries that have emigrated here. So we need to work with people from Minnesota to get that degree and become teachers.
Amber?
Yeah, so as somebody who came directly from the Dominican Republic about 19 years ago to Minnesota, I asked my question, what am I doing here every day? But the reality is that, you know, I think to both of your points, Minnesota is a great place to live. We haven't done a really great job, though, of actually welcoming people to come in or to stay sometimes in Minnesota when it comes to communities of color, when it comes to our Latino communities, and that's something that we really need to work on. We also have, so I think there's a couple of things when it comes to teacher diversity. One is that even though we have some great programs happening, Grow Your Own at MPS is a good example, Breakthrough Twin Cities, TFA, these are all different organizations that are doing right now a really good job of training and getting experience for teachers of color that are interested in education. I think there's one barrier though that there's the kind of the short term and the long term, right? Long term, I think there's so many things that we're doing that we can continue to do when it comes to access to the higher education, access to teacher licensure, being not having so many barriers to be accessible. In terms of recruiting folks from outside that have experience, but also in terms of growing our own here in Minnesota. We have a lot of amazing professionals in communities of color already, in Latino communities, African American communities, Native communities, Asian communities, that are interested and have a calling to do education, that already have degrees. But we have created so many barriers to being able to access the teaching certifications and then the teacher licensure and then to become, to go from being already a professional to going into your first year of teaching where the salaries are not comparable, it's hard for people to give that up. And oftentimes we're coming from first generation Latino families or other families, and so we're not going to, you know, after we've moved up and gained experience, even if we have a calling to education and to work with young people, to set ourselves, you know, back when it comes to our finances and everything else. So it's something that's real there. The other piece is walking into teams and schools and systems that oftentimes we've already had historical negative experiences with. We are, you know, the education systems that we work with in are oftentimes the greatest, have had the been the greatest oppressors towards some of our communities. So we have to do a lot of work when it comes to creating equity and building a community that, that teachers and adults of color and from Latino communities are coming into that are welcoming, that value them, where they're not tokenized, where they're not the only one, and where they're also seeing success happening and feel a team environment. One of the things that Hiawatha has been doing this year is, and last year, is that we have taken equity as one of our priorities for the last 2 years. And that means that in order for us to be able to be a welcoming environment for the adults and to be doing justice to the education, relevant education that we provide to our scholars, we have to do a lot of soul searching and self-reflection and have a lot of tough conversations that do involve privilege and racism and all of the things that intersect with when we talk about social justice and equity. And so that's some of the things that we are doing. We're creating a welcoming environment, we're addressing equity head on and having all of the really tough conversations that need to be had by 180 staff members. And we need to do that. We need to do that for our scholars, and we need to do that so that our staff of color and our Latino staff come in and want to stay there for the long haul.
Yeah, I'm an immigrant from Jamaica also, so there's not a Latin language issue there, although Jamaica was a Spanish colony for a little bit of time before British actually make the Spanish word Jamaica. So, but I did come to Minnesota professionally with as a designer to work for an organization here, and so I came here originally, and they had to really sweeten the pot to get me to move to Minnesota. Even I got a down jacket. and then my wife, who moved here also to work for Ford Motor Company, didn't even recognize the state when she was invited to move here, and found it to be very, very lonely place for a woman of color, and at that time, 1990, and you know, everybody, young person wants to get married, to have a social life, and that's where you find this revolving door as people leave because they can't connect enough as they would in other parts of the country. So. It seems then that there would be pressure on corporations and pressure on the school system to undo any obstacles to the barriers to facilitate and compensate for the cold and the numbers, the lack of cultural opportunities, which is growing but still a little slim. And so it's really vital for us to create things like the Grow Your Own program. Now we have to dismantle the barriers to the Board of Teaching and open that up. We can't say that we're such a great state, we're nice people, we love everybody, and then have systemic things in which we operate comfortably that become barriers. But we get to still be nice people. If we're nice people, we'll do the tough thing of dismantling barriers that are systemic, so that people can come in easily and stay longer.
Well, thanks. Those are great conversation points. And, you know, I want to make a comment and ask a question. You know, being born and raised here in St. Paul, Minnesota, you know, our priority back in the 60s and 70s was to graduate. But there was no going home, telling your dad or your mom that you dropped out of high school. And that's why I am so involved in this achievement gap. And at the same time, I'm puzzled because we hear the comments always made, well, Latinos, well, they have such value of family. You hear this all the time. In marketing, well, family values. When you talk to political parties, family values. Well, for me, with a 50% dropout rate, that kid is going home and telling their mom and dad they're going to leave school. And someone's making the decision to let them. This, think about this. They're going home and saying, I'm not going to go to school. I'm dropping out. At this day and age, no. No, that doesn't make sense. So I'm puzzled there. I'm with Mitch Perlstein about the family. And something's happening to the Latino family. Evolving from, yes, you're going to school, for sure, with my mom and dad. And my mom and dad never did speak English. They were here their whole lives and didn't read or write. But they valued us going to school. And you know, I think they had a commitment to the country. They loved this country. So they thought, one of the things we have to do when we get to live here is we have to get our kids to school. And that's a commitment. Is the community not making that commitment? Are people coming here and not feeling they owe this country something? Is there a dialogue now that we owe them something? I'm feeling that.
Feel it too.
I don't like it.
I don't like it.
And I'm puzzled by it, but that has to stop. And so my question is this. Yes, we have the majority of teachers are Anglos. Why? Well, obviously, over the years, these talented kids and students made a decision they're going to go and teach. Why? Well, they said it's a good profession. It's a good profession to get in. We can help the community. We can give back. And there's a certain, you know, and people have a certain passion about teaching. I see that. And that's why we have, and that's why over the years, thousands of Anglo students have made the decision to go teach. So now we have our Latino community. We're the largest minority in the country. We're growing by leaps and bounds. And we have this crisis here. This is a crisis. If we have 50% of our kids not graduating nationally, and we're supposed to be this growing community that's going to make a difference in the United States of America, where are these decisions being made by this community, the Latino community? Look around, there's not many Latinos here. We are in the heart, right here, of the Latino community, and they've been invited. Look around. They're not here. So my question is this, and I'm going to ask you, is the Latino community engaged in this crisis? Because a year ago, Valeria Silva, who was then St. Paul Superintendent of Schools, said they weren't engaged. Right here on the stage, they were not engaged. I'm going to ask you, it's a tough question: is the Latino community engaged in this crisis or not? And you can let me know whatever which way you want to be able to answer that. Thank you.
So I can start. At Hiawatha Academies, about 85% of our families are coming from the Latino community. And as somebody who's worked for many years previously also at Casa de Esperanza, doing community engagement work, I can say that the Latino community is really engaged and also really invested in education. I truly believe, and this is something that Lupe Serrano always used to say, was, you know, that if we provide the resources, the information, the tools to our community members, 99.9% of them are going to do what's in the best interest of themselves and their communities. But we have to remember that there's a lot of historical context, that there's a lot of historical context here at play, and in particular when it comes to education and barriers systemically and oftentimes intentionally set up for communities of color not to go into the education profession. When we desegregated in this country schools, before that, even though we had kind of the separate but equal, we had tons of teachers of color teaching kids in their communities of color. And after desegregation, what happened was we desegregated, forced children of color to go into white schools, but didn't hire those African American and other teachers of color to go into those white schools. Barriers were systemically created so that they wouldn't go there. And that's, you know, we're talking 40, 50 years ago, and that has continued in some way, shape, or form as a barrier to get people to have access to education. The previous panel is also talking about, you know, the zip codes that we have and how we're, you know, the zip codes determine oftentimes the quality of education and the kind of experience you are going to have in your school. And unfortunately, as I mentioned before, many of our young people now that could have potentially been in college have been told by our teachers and our community, you're too poor, you are too immigrant, you're too black or brown, you're too, and we have whether intentionally or not, set low expectations for our communities. Teachers walk in and without oftentimes knowing it, say, oh, that child will not be the most successful because of their background. How do we know this? There's actually a lot of data that shows, you know, that what college and career counselors at schools, you know, tell kids that are kids of color in terms of what their pathway is versus white kids. There is tons of data that shows that white children and children of middle and upper class are counseled into going into four-year careers, into engineering, into the math, into the sciences, while kids of colors are told either nothing or they're counseled into going into a technical college or something easier. Without any background or data of what that child's hopes and dreams are, right? It's solely based off of what they see and who they see in front of them. So we have a lot of work to do. It's really, you know, as somebody who does community engagement, and I'll stop very quickly here, it's very easy for us to blame our communities for what they're not doing. But we're the ones getting paid to make sure that we're engaging them effectively, and we're the ones who have to look at ourselves in a mirror and figure out what is it that we're not doing right, and why are communities not coming to us, not engaging, because when we figure out how to engage communities effectively and when we create a sense of agency within our communities that have already been told over and over again, this is not your place, this is, even if they were born and raised here, this is not your place, this is not your space, if we haven't done our due diligence in engaging effectively and also providing them with meaningful, relevant, applicable tools, information, resources so that they can engage with each other and find their own solutions and not try to come at it from a place that we know best and try to tell our communities what to do, they lead the way and they show us. And I think that there's lots of examples of that. We have a family academy at Hiawatha Academies in which families come to, and you know, I see the difference between a family that comes in deferring to the system, not knowing how to kind of navigate the system, to having information and resources and those tools, and holding us accountable and being engaging in meaningful ways.
Okay, at Minneapolis Public School, I oversee global education, English learners, etc. So I do not oversee family engagement. However, we work very closely with family engagement. And I'm not going to repeat, you know, everything that Amber said, but I will tell you that of the 36,000 students that we do have, about 6,400 are Latinos, which is about 17% of our student population. And I do believe that our families have not failed. We, as a system, have failed them. We need to do this outreach for them. As you know, Rick, I come from a culture where we seem to think that that our children go to school and now I'm not going to get that much involved because I have given you my children. We expect our teachers, our administrators. That's how most, the majority of the families in Minneapolis public school are from Mexico. There isn't a concept of family engagement, so we do have to do the outreach to our families and engage them. And it's one thing that we initiated in a program called Operation Graduation, because for our students to graduate from high school and go on to college and college readiness, you know, post-secondary, it doesn't start in ninth grade. It starts really in preschool. So we are working together with communications and family engagement to do the outreach. We do have a superior program where we also do have, you know, parents attend classes and all that to show them how to navigate the system. But there is one thing, too, that I think that we need to do as a state. We do need to put some more funding in family engagement. There isn't enough resources. And it's not that money can fix everything, but sometimes the budget for family engagement are so small that some of our Latino parents do not have transportation, they do not have daycare, and you know, how do we provide that when they come to us? Provide food for them, for the children, and also the daycare, and send that taxi to come. It does cost, you know, it does cost, cost money to do that. So I am very hopeful that by working at Minneapolis Public School, everyone together, we're gonna do more outreach for our families. There are some schools that Minneapolis do excellent outreach to our Latino families. I have been to many of the activities in the evenings at Green Central, at Emerson. So where we have a lot of our Latino population, we are doing a great job, but it's not just the one where we had like an 80%. We need to make sure that we are reaching every Latino family.
Thank you. I agree with both, and I really want to piggyback on some of that related to some personal stories. You know, I remember my mom talking about when she was 5 years old in the 1950s in New York. As I said, there was no ESL program yet, and she had just started school, all white students in the class with her, and she had to go to the bathroom, and she tried to tell the teacher, but she only knew how to speak Spanish, and the teacher really didn't do much to try to understand what she was talking about and just kind of kept trying to get her to be quiet. Ultimately, she ended up going to the bathroom on herself. It was her first experience in an institutional environment. These are the types of things that make it difficult for any immigrant family coming into the United States is we don't do a good job of crossing that culture and really understanding the needs, whether it be language, whether it be values, whether it be beliefs, and really helping them to make that gap, traverse that gap. You know, another thing that she told me about was that, you know, my grandmother, you know, until she died at the age of 96, she never really understood and spoke very good English. So at the age of 7, my mom would go with my grandmother to the welfare office and translate the forms to the social worker. You know, these weren't really good experiences for my mom and grandmother in terms of, again, navigating the political structures that are in place that that we really need to be able to get through in order to be successful in the United States. You know, when I think about my father and a lot of the things that he's talked about growing up, you know, the criminal justice system, the police, any kind of government agency was something to be afraid of because, you know, you might not have the right papers or they might ask you questions that you don't have the right answers to. And so, yes, it can be really difficult to get through a lot of those structures that are in place for us to be successful and for us to be able to help our students be successful. Where I think our Latinos show up consistently is in the home. You know, my parents were consistently in the home in terms of telling us how smart we were and how important education was and how important it is to work hard. That's where those values and beliefs were passed on to that next generation. The ability to be able to get through the political dynamics and the institutions, that's a struggle. You know, one last story, and this is related to, you know, when I was doing some work with colleges, there was an institution who wanted to increase their number of Latino students and in the community. And so they created daycare for the young single mothers to bring their kids in so that they can go to school. And they did not take advantage of the daycare program. And so a lot of the administrators said, well, you know, Latinos just don't value education. And once there was further work done and some people that came in to help outreach and understand what were some of the issues, they found out that in the Latino community, you didn't just trust your kids with someone that you didn't know. You didn't drop off your kids with strangers, right? You allowed your aunts or your nieces or your mother, your grandmother to take care of your children. And those were systems that weren't necessarily in place. So it's really easy for us to make assumptions about the commitments that certain populations have to values when we don't fully understand the culture. So, you know, part of what we're talking about is not only about Latinos having that commitment and doing what they need to do to understand these systems, but it's also a really important thing for all of us that are not Latino to do our part in understanding the culture and not just apply our own values and judgments on other people as the way to determine what they think, what they believe, and what they think is important.
Yeah, I tend to agree with what's been said. We have a ad hoc committee of ESL committee on the board, and we go into the community and listen to the concerns of people, and quite frankly, I was surprised to hear parents repeatedly saying that they felt that when they tried to engage, that they were not welcome. And that was astounding to me to hear when in fact we are trying to create engagement. So I don't know, you know, what our factors are at play exactly there. I haven't heard this, our side of the story yet, but it's a surprise, and I read a book called The Privileged Ones, and it's by a Harvard professor who, it's an old book, did some research on rich families, and to see how rich people raise their children to become unjust leaders of the world, basically. Well, how the perpetuation of injustice is in the hands of the rich, but we are always studying the poor. So he decided to study the rich, and he discovered one thing among many, that rich people see teachers as servants, and poor people see teachers as leaders. And so when middle class or a rich person sends their child into a school, they aren't sending the child to be taught by an employee. Whereas when a poor person sends, there's an intimidation factor that's built in. You don't feel you have certain rights to ask certain questions, and in fact, you should stay away, and these people are the experts, they know how to take care of your child. You don't know that information, they know best. And so, understanding that, then, that you have a certain amount of power in the eyes of the parents of your children, then there is an enormous obligation to then become humble ourselves and to bring ourselves to the level of the people we're serving and even below, and to welcome them as we would welcome someone who might be intimidated by us. And I don't think that a district fully realizes that is a seemingly ethereal thing, but it plays out when you go to a community meeting and you hear the community saying, "I don't feel welcome." You realize that we're not conscious of some of the dynamics that are happening.
Well, all very interesting statements, and I appreciate that. I have one final question. To close this out, and I think it's an important question. But you know, in speaking to the community and in trying to get dialogue and trying to get some united efforts with the Latino community, it's not always the easiest thing to do. But I just want to give you a practical example of what companies go through. I was talking to a local bank that was struggling with their Hispanic marketing, and they're a small bank. They have a couple banks in neighborhoods, but I went to meet with their board, and I would ask them. I said, "Well, it seems to me that your efforts in reaching the Hispanic market are hiring a Latino and then having him or her reach out and do the marketing and try to get the people there, and some efforts, maybe you're not giving enough budget, it doesn't work, and then you hire someone else. And there's been this whole list of Latinos who are in banking. There have been 10 banks so far. They're everywhere. Wells Fargo, the U.S. Bank, we keep on going. And I said, your problem is you as a board don't know anything about Hispanic marketing. You don't know if it's right or if it's wrong or what this person is doing. What is that marketing plan about? You have to learn about it. And you know what? You're professionals. You're in the banking industry. Why wouldn't you want to learn about it? It's a growing market. Your bank in the future will be relying on those multicultural clients. And they took it to heart, and I did see them come to one of our marketing conferences. They have a whole different plan there. It was a wake-up call. They know about it. If you go to those directors, they know about Hispanic marketing. And I think some of the things we're very talking about is that our Anglo counterparts haven't taken the time, you know, to actually learn about it instead of being hiring someone that's Latino or someone that's Black, hoping they're going to be doing the right thing for you. It may be survival, but if you don't know about it, obviously there's a problem. Here's my question, and we'll close with this one as we are going to see on schedule. I want you to be candid and mention a roadblock. Roadblocks here in Minnesota, whether it's the unions, whether it's the schools, the school districts. What are the roadblocks to having more diverse teachers?
I think one of the main ones is the Board of Teaching. And of course, there's a lawsuit that was successful against the board, because even though the law was passed to facilitate access, the actual day-to-day practices didn't change. And people from out of town and want to come to teach here have had to jump through too many hoops and very often failed. And teaching is a calling, but it ain't that much of a calling that you're gonna totally put your life on hold and go jump through a lot of hoops when you have alternatives. And we have to begin to again break down those systemic barriers, and that is one of the areas I'm looking forward to now, the change that will happen.
I think I'll echo what Don said. I think the systemic barriers that were created through the Board of Teaching have been a huge barrier. Also, I think once you know, we think about as a country, what do we value, right? I think that there has not been the teaching profession hasn't had the prestige necessarily that it should have. We need doctors. We have a huge emphasis on healthcare, and we have doctors going to school, and doctors get paid well, right? We have a huge emphasis on education. Educators are the ones that train our doctors, but we don't yet value them in the way and give them the prestige that they deserve. I think we have amazing teachers in the districts, in charter schools, in private schools. In terms of diversifying our workforce, we need to do a better job at making sure that our education is more relevant to our children, because right now it is not. And when we create those spaces in which we can have a more relevant education for our children, that will also attract more diverse communities, because they want to provide what is true and relevant to them for their communities. We need to work on equity within our school systems. That's really important. And make it a place, an environment where people can be their full authentic selves. And that's not always allowed and okay in our systems and in our adult culture. And so those are just a few of the barriers that I think that we encounter.
You know, I will echo what both Dan and Amber do say, but I also would have to say that besides the role of teaching, I also have to say that it's the union. I would say that because of the tenure law, a lot of times, you know, we seem to let go of those new teachers. And also when we talk in comparing careers, there are not too many minority students who want to go into teaching. Because I know that if I am bilingual, I can make more money going into a different industry. So our teachers are, you know, underpaid, and we seem to think sometimes that they are working the 9 months. No, they also are preparing themselves during the summer, taking another professional development. So students are now comparing careers, and I tell you an example. My youngest daughter said, Mom, I want to go into education. I said, what is your other option? I want to be a doctor. So go be a doctor. You know, and I am in education myself. But she's simply mad. And she tutored this summer, but she volunteered at Minneapolis public schools, and then she came back to say, I like education, but I don't want to become a teacher. They work so hard, Mom. I said, well, don't you think the doctors work hard too? And then she said, yes, they do, but they get paid better. So, you know, young kids are looking at those salaries. And again, going back to the role of teaching, I take a look at the years that it takes to go to college for an engineering, for a teacher. That's the 4 years. But look at the comparisons in salaries, you know, in the private industry or public industry with our career and our teaching career. And then when I take a look again at the labor union laws, is the tenure, I think that we have some great teachers, innovative teachers that are coming out, but they are losing their jobs. We have to let them go because of the rules and regulations.
So no student should ever go through all of their public school years saying that they've never had a person of color as a teacher. That's just wrong. And you know, when I think about the schools that really need to do a better job, I think about a lot of the suburban schools that really have not had that hard push to recruit and retain teachers of color. And yet our suburban areas are becoming more and more multicultural. I think one of the things that those schools need to focus on is recruitment, really building those pipeline programs, sort of like the ones you guys are talking about with the colleges, and early on, really making it attractive for people to, once they graduate, go into these schools. And even if there are, you know, one of just a few people of color teachers, we need those few to really start that groundswell so that eventually we have that place of inclusion. Because that's the second thing, you know, when people come into the schools and they don't feel like they're included, like they have the support they need to succeed, they do have choices to move on to other places. So, you know, creating that culture of inclusion also means cultural competency for all of the administrators and all the other teachers so that we can have an environment where being multicultural is not seen as a deficit, but an asset. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to have time for a couple of questions. So, Rob, could you get that microphone, please? And maybe this one here.
Okay, questions?
What can white educators do to involve and honor educators of color?
I can start. So some of the work that we're doing right now at Hiawatha, and I say this because I think that it is something that white educators, and frankly all educators, can do, is we can do our research, do our homework, right? It's not okay for us to go to our colleague who is from that community and ask all the questions and put the burden on our colleagues of the expectation that they should speak for an entire community. And that's oftentimes what we tend to do. So I would say, do your research and your homework about the historical context, the societies, the communities, and then you can approach people from the communities that are different from yours in the context of wanting to learn but already having some background information. That's one thing. I think also understanding on also understanding that to be somebody who is an aspiring ally doesn't mean that you do it only within the context of your work, that you also have to hold the people around you accountable to the racism, the racist slurs, the prejudice, and everything else that's happening around you. Because I think people of color can tell when somebody is in this and wants to feel good about the work that they're doing for the poor children and don't see this as something that's tied directly to their own humanity and to their own stakes in terms of building a better society.
I will approach from what can we as a district do to be more inclusive, to include our white teachers, in this endeavor that we all want every student to succeed. Definitely the equity training that many of us are doing in our district, but also too, I think that as educators, we went into education because we love that profession, and we must own every children that is in that classroom. So how is it that we as district can train our content teachers, now these are second language teachers, to see through that lens? Because I believe that when you use strategies that you use for English learners, that strategy is good for any student. We have a lot of our white students that are also, there is a gap, in the state that we don't mention much, but there is that white gap also for our white students. So I think that the training that we can do for our teachers needs to be definitely more than what we are doing. Teachers are great. They are great teachers and they want to do their best. But sometimes we just have to do more training. We have to invest more in professional development.
I think regardless of whether you're white, Latino, Black, whatever, cultural competency is something that you continually have to learn and grow in. It's a lifelong learning process. And, when you look at the diversity dimensions, there are hundreds of them. So, whether it's learning about the Latino culture or understanding how to create a place of inclusion for your transgender students, or being able to provide the right support for students with disabilities. It really is about understanding students holistically, all the different things that impact their ability to learn, and that you're taking the opportunity to not understand the research behind it, because there's a lot of stuff that you can read and learn from, but also developing those personal connections, because there's no research or data out there that's gonna help you develop that trust that you need with the individual students that you're trying to impact.
Okay, Randy? I had a question, but I want to reference an article that was in the Star Tribune on March 28, 2016. I'd like to know what you guys think about this. So you were talking about, Elia, that your daughter, I agree with that. The younger people have a perception that teaching doesn't pay as well. And of course, we've got a lot of young people graduating college who can't even find jobs today. But this was an article by Alejandra Matos, dated March 28th, that says St. Paul Public Schools, and this is really where we have to, we're not attacking education throughout Minnesota. I think a lot of the emphasis of this discussion is on Minneapolis and St. Paul Public Schools. St. Paul Public School teachers, more than half of all teachers in St. Paul earn more than $75,000 a year, wages not seen by most teachers across the state. And in Minneapolis as well, even in Minneapolis Public Schools, a comparable urban district, only a third of teachers earn more than $75,000 a year. So I kind of want to go back to your thought. I mean, do the young people realize that the public schools in Minneapolis, or particularly in St. Paul, are paying this much in wages? And maybe that's part of the problem, is the public's perception of the performance of 50%, graduation rates of Hispanics and African Americans when they just raised their pay in July 4% again. That's where the disconnect and the problem is the public sees this as a poor investment if we're paying this much in wages, but we're getting the results that we're getting.
So if you are talking about the average, and I think that in any district depends what is the age level that they have been in education. So as a young person coming out of college, and I'm going to be making that 36,000 to 38,000 or 40,000, let's say, in the district compared to what my colleague who went into the engineering is going to be making, the 60,000 to 70,000. I think that they, like my daughter was seeing the initial, and you're talking about the average for Minneapolis and St. Paul, that is not the average as you know in the rural areas, for example. So that is very high, and it depends on the years of experience that they have in the average. So if those teachers in Minneapolis or St. Paul have been teaching for all those years, and they are more, you know, older, of course they may be the average. But I think that young people today are seeing what they're gonna make when they start at the beginning of the program.
I think it's also very, so I'm at a charter school, and it's a little bit different. We have so charter schools receive about 30% less per child than the district does. So we operate with a smaller amount of funding, and we're still really invested in making sure that we have quality teachers, and we have teachers coming from diverse backgrounds. We also have a very different way of operating when it comes to compensation. It's very, very based on accountability, right? It's based on child performance, and we've been in the top performing schools closing the opportunity gap in the state for several years now in a row. And we're really proud of that and have been able to do that with amazing teachers. But we are also very worried about losing amazing teachers, because there is a cap in terms of where they can go in our schools, in the charter schools. So that's something that I can say in terms of that. It's just, I think, a little bit different than the district.
Rob? Oh, Frank, did you have one final?
Yes, just a quick question. Yeah. On the military bases of enlisted men across the world, Korea, Germany, Japan, African-American, Hispanic-Americans, and white Americans, all the children do almost identically in their test scores. So is this not indicative of a cultural, of a local thing, rather than it's not a teaching issue, it's more of a systemic problem? And then you also ask that what brings people to Minnesota, aren't the top three employers in Minnesota the state, the federal government, and the county government?
Let me finish with the real quick story.
How long the story?
There we go.
I've had good friendships with the Hmong community, and Kahui Yang was the leader of the Laotian Family Council, and I became friends with him when we were down in the state capitol. And so I was walking around with him and showing him the history of Minnesota, and we were talking about the different governors. And it just kind of is a natural flow of conversation. Who do you think the first Hmong governor will be in Minnesota? And it just caught him by surprise, because he didn't think that Hmong could be the governors of Minnesota. So what I'm saying is the power of a dream really elevates what we're trying to do. And so if we think about who's the first Latino governor of Minnesota, that's when we start elevating the dreams of what can come out of a Latino community. I'll end on that.
Thanks, Gary. I'm going to have our panel. Great stuff. You know what we're going to do? We're going to call, because it's such an important topic about seeing what the actual youth are doing. So we're going to have everybody just keep their seats, and we're going to invite Rob Hansen to come up here. Rob's going to introduce our next group here. So Rob, come on up. But I want to thank everyone for the panel. Diverse teachers. It's important to have, hard to get. That's something we have to stay on top of. It's very important. And our next panel we call it the ALMA's Career Exploration Event, and it's a case study about someone who's taken the efforts, a school that's taken the efforts to graduate Latinos, a school that the teachers are working together, the superintendent's working with this issue, and those are the type of things that we want to find out about. I think that in this challenge that we have, when our when our Commissioner of Education says that they've done about all they can for reaching students of color, and now it's up to the other forces in the community. I want to talk about what's happening in this particular school, and I want to hand it over to Rob. Rob, take over and talk to us about the Alma's Career Exploration Event.
Okay. Hola, buenos días. Todavía, creo que sí. Buenos días.
Buenos días.
Buenos días. I'm Roberto, or I'm Rob, full-blooded Scandinavian, güero, por todo.
No.
However, let me give you just a little bit of reason why I'm here. Full-blooded Scandinavian guy. When I was at Mankato State, I met this young lady who happened to be my wife. And I became aware of this problem in Minnesota regarding the Hispanic dropout rate. And so I wasn't sure what I was going to do, but I decided I was going to go into education as my last degree. And so what happened is I didn't understand why. How could that be? The 50% of Latinos were dropping out. It didn't make sense to me. In all of my life, my parents taught me that, because I was always skinny and smaller than everybody else in sports, that if you fight for something, you can change it. And so I figured, well, maybe I can. Maybe I can do something about it. So I interviewed 84 Hispanic dropouts to find out why. And one of the big reasons was that they did not feel that they were part of the school that they went to. They always said, yo voy a Sibley, or yo fui. I went to Sibley. I went to South St. Paul. I went to Le Sueur. I went to Mankato. They were never a Warrior. They were never a Packer. They went there. And so I created a master's thesis on how to keep kids in school. 2001, I began my program at Henry Sibley. We had that dropout rate. It was about 60% at Sibley. Over 15 years now, that was 2001. It didn't happen overnight. It's a job, it's work. You have to find people like Carmen Robles who are willing to meet with you and be with you and help in the community. You have to have administrators like I have at my school. You have to have board members. They're here. Superintendent that is here. You know, that are interested in making a change. And at Henry Sibley High School, with our largest population Latino, we have two elementary schools that are over 50% Latino. We are an inner ring suburban school, which means we have a lot of Latinos coming from the city. I've got kids talking about school choice. I've got kids in my program that are at Henry Sibley High School that are a block and a half away from this building here on the west side. I've got kids in my program from Eagan, in Monroe Heights, South St. Paul. They choose to come to Sibley because we have changed our environment through the population, that we have, the administrators and the teachers. The problem is that I'm last after hearing all these great things that people are saying, so I'm sorry, I'm going off on a tangent. But anyway, so yeah, there's lots of things that we could talk about and what we've done. Not I, but we've done it in our district. So yeah, our graduation right now, through the last 8 years, has been hovering above and below 90% for Latino population. There wasn't a book to tell me how to do this, or how we should do it, although I'm writing one. But anyway, so here's specifically what we're talking about today is this career event. What happened regarding this is that through conversations with kids, for some reason when I talk to kids in the elementary schools in our district, all of them have the same dreams as everyone else. A fireman, an engineer, a president, whatever it was. But for some reason when they got to be juniors or seniors, yeah, I got them to graduate, but their goals had changed. And now they were thinking, maybe, you know, going to a two-year college and getting some other type of a degree instead of thinking high above. And part of that was that I believe in is the conversation as well. We don't have teachers of color in our district. We don't have many. We need more. But in regards to that, I asked my kids, how many of you know the president of the Hispanic, let's see, I don't want to get this right, all right? The president for the Society of Hispanic Professional Engineers. There is one. He's here.
Whoa.
He's on the stage. All right. We also have the president of Hispanic Contractors. I mean, Hispanic Contractors is here.
Yay.
Engineers. All right. What we ended up doing, and thanks to my superintendent and my principal, and getting me kind of in line, because I'm kind of scatterbrained, going all over the place sometimes, but we also got the Chamber of Commerce for Dakota County to be involved in this. And we organized an event at the high school. We had over 27 professionals that came into the building to meet with my kids. And when I talk about my kids, that's my Latino kids in the school. We had over 80 kids come into after school on their own to talk with these professionals. Over 27, the majority were Latinos. Lawyers, doctors, dentists, all of them Latinos. Then the problem is that a lot of times they're not visible for my kids. They don't see them. And so they don't, yeah, they had that dream to start with, but they never saw them when they were growing up. So then for some reason they lost it. And that's part of my problem as well. I didn't help them with that. We didn't as a district. But now we are. And so, like these guys are on the stage, and this is one of my alma students, one of my leaders, they sat down and talked to them about what was their path. How did they get there? Yeah, what were the barriers? But how did I overcome them? How could you overcome them? And they sat down in different groups with different kids based on their interests. And the result, as far as the kids were concerned, was overwhelming. They loved it. So it's going to become an annual thing now. And as far as, believe it, over 20 professionals, Latinos, 27 total, came to my school. They took off from work. And you talk about community engagement. Yeah. They want to engage. The professionals want to engage. We need to give them an area so that they can do that. All right? One of the problems of a district is, in my experience, is we open up our doors and say, come to us. It's like, teachers, just come to us. Or professionals, just come to my building. No, you need to go out and find them. And that's part of what we do. And so that's how this came about. It was a wonderful thing, and I just want to present the two gentlemen here. They can present themselves and let them know, I should say, how it was for them.
Okay, vote for Pedro. Inside joke. It was a really good time. I was invited to go. I was very happy to go. When I first went there, I didn't know what to expect. I've never done anything like that before. And it was interesting to hear and see the faces of the students that were there that had no idea that there was people of color that were Latinos that were out there doing what their dreams were, because they didn't see them. A lot of people don't know who Latinos are when they're in the room. My name is Foster Hackett. I'm a Latino. My mother immigrated here. She was a family of migrant workers, and they settled here a long time ago. And along came the hippies in the 60s, and she met my dad, who's of German descent, and I was one of the first products of biracial marriages in the state. So here I am today. But yes, I am bilingual, and I am a Latino, and it was fun. I had a great time. It was more engaging than I thought, talking to these students. These children today, they don't lack desire. They lack direction. And it's our job as adults to direct them. We don't have to be their fathers or their uncles. If we see somebody that needs direction, that's looking for it, help them. Take them aside. Let them know they're not alone. There's a lot of students and a lot of children out there that are in broken families. They don't have that father figure. You know, people in general need to get involved in their community, whether it's going to the Boys and Girls Club and volunteering time, or if it's being a big brother, big sister. We as adults in our city have a responsibility to make it better, not just complain about it and expect our government to do it. If anybody in here thinks and is going to wait for the government to change our education system for the better, you're going to be waiting for a long time. So we as adults, we need to put the foot forward. We all need to meet these students like Pedro and myself did. We need to go out there. We need to get involved. We need to be coaches on baseball teams. We need to be coaches on soccer teams. We need to be in libraries. We need to be involved. And that's what's really going to make the difference. When these kids see people of color next to them doing what they're dreaming of doing, and then they know that they can achieve it.
Good morning or good afternoon. Good morning.
Good morning.
First, I want to thank Rick, Aguilera, and Rob for inviting me to this event. My name is Pedro Lopez, and unlike most of the stories that you may have heard here, I actually went to Wayzata High School. And when I work for OSHA compliance after graduating from my campus as well, my degree was in criminal justice to be a police officer. That is mysterious ways to work with people, and I'm one of those examples. After starting with compliance OSHA in Minnesota, I investigated numerous of serious injuries and fatality accidents in the construction industry and general industry. At that point, because I was a public employee, I could not necessarily help our community in the way that I wanted to. When I left compliance OSHA, I joined probably the biggest contractor in the state of Minnesota and worked on projects like the Target Field, the Gopher Stadium, the Union Depot. I was in charge of the safety of the whole project, managing anywhere from 900 to 1,300 field workers. Now, my experience is, Robert said, is probably similar after I graduated from high school, when I went to college, and when I worked, that I was the pioneer. I'm the first and only Hispanic, Latino, Mexican origin person that ever worked for Minnesota OSHA and for the largest construction company in the state of Minnesota, probably one of the three largest in the country. The experience in both employments was very difficult, to say the least. But nonetheless, when I went to work for the private company, I realized that there was a need, that there were other organizations which provide wonderful services. If you wanted to develop or open a tortilleria, bakery, restaurant, and such, there are places that did help and do help, like, not to give any publicity, Minnesota Safety Council, and other organizations that like to provide safety training for people. However, there was not a single organization, for-profit, non-profit, private or public, that served the needs of the Hispanic Latino construction community. As a result, just to give you some numbers, we Hispanic Latinos are the number one in fatalities in the construction industry. Okay? That was the original reason as to why we developed and created the Hispanic Contractors Association. It's okay, I won't hold it again.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
precisely because there isn't an organization like ours in the state of Minnesota. You've got the local unions who do a great job training the students or the members in the skill to be competent, but they do not have the ability to teach them in Spanish. Now, by the year 2020, we, the Hispanic Latino workforce, will be 19%, not just in construction, it's according to the U.S. Department of Labor. So we need to engage, like Foster said, I'm sorry you speak so eloquently, I could not remember what you said. But we need to engage our Latino Hispanic community, also because connecting back to education, one of my board members just sent me a text stating that 66% of Latinos that don't go to college is still because of economical reasons. So, we can put all the reasons together and pinpoint the top three. but we still have to, as a community, as adults, as professionals, as organizations, we still need to do our duties and reach out to every single one of them and give them an option, whether it's construction, which, to be quite honest, it is a hard job, Pfizer can tell you this, but it's an honest, good-paying job. If you have pensions, and obviously if you do work with a good employer, they will be taking care of you in regards to safety. Again, our passion, our philosophy is that we want to make sure that no one gets hurt. And yes, although our name is the Hispanic Contractors Association, we have had Anglo members and East African members as contractors because they see the services that we provide that there are no other organizations that provide the services. And all our services are free. They're part of a membership. And all of our board members, including myself, we do this for free. We're in 501c6, which obviously for most of you know, we can't and we do not want to ask for grants. You know, just what Foster said, public money, grants, and government. I feel that we have to take the initiative to change what has been done already and create opportunities for ourselves and for our young students.
So at the event we had, it was in like December-ish time, and it was pretty cool to be honest, because, well, like Rob said, we had a bunch of professionals come in and talk to us, and like I didn't even know those jobs existed. Yeah, like it's just not known to us as kids, I guess, but a lot of us learned a lot, and we ended up talking about it for like at least a week, and like it did set our expectations higher of what we could do, and I thought it was pretty cool.
So as you can see, I mean, the way these gentlemen spoke, I mean, you can see why the kids were talking about it for the next week and why really their expectations rose because of it. I mean, just listening to them, all of you are thinking, wow, I wish I could have talked to that guy. You know, and I had 27 professionals giving that same type of a message, and to over 80 kids. And so that's this event, that's what we did, and that's what we created thanks to a lot of different groups. And that's really the essential thing that I would like to say is that one district can't do anything just by itself. And Elia would say that as well, as far as she's had to go off and find people elsewhere as well to come in, we've had to find, and that's what we've done. I mean, the district has done that, finding organizations outside that can help us. And that's the best thing that advice I could give to any district is that in education it's also awfully hard for a lot of educators to get help. They want to do things themselves, but nothing will get done unless really we work together with other organizations to help us. So that's our case study. We'll see how the kids, I've got a lot of seniors this year, so we'll see where they go. So thank you. Any questions?
And as Robert said, working together, it takes the whole vision as a child, it takes the whole state to move our Latinos forward. And I think that we as administrators have to support, not just by providing the avenue to do this, but also financially on what projects like this do for our students. Because if not, you probably need help, because I know you. And you should have some help, because you did a great job. If you have raised a graduation rate by that much, this is an example that we should be following in many districts. So, if they don't support you, I'm going to steal you.
All right.
other questions?
Are they replicating this program in other schools, and have you thought about trying to do it?
It's definitely able to be replicated. We have a Jóvenes de Salud that spawned, came out of this program. Carmen Robles brought it to Harding. We've got, I don't know if Rafa is still here.
He's doing the radio.
Oh, he's in the radio. The problem, oftentimes schools have come to me and want to know what to do or if they can. It requires passion. It requires a district that's going to support that passion from somebody or people. In our district, luckily, I have that support, and they're willing to target something. And not every district is willing to do that. The people that are in charge, like I say, the passion has to be there to be able to go to houses in the middle of the night or take phone calls in the middle of the night, because once you get in with a community that especially is an immigrant community much of the time, once you bridge that, especially in my case, I've bridged the white community or institution to a Latino community and have developed the relationship with that Latino community, then other services that are needs come through me. And so Almas has created opportunities through employment, social services, anything that the immigrant community or Latino community needs, I've developed those resources, and it's just not me. I mean, I've found people to do that, and so I'm not saying I'm the cure for everything, but it's just, like I said, I've found people that are willing to help. And so we've tried to replicate in different places. We need a Carmen Robles at every school.
Right.
That kind of thing.
But it was because of Penn Mississippi High School that Johnson, Harding High School, South St. Paul High School was able to get involved. It was peer-to-peer. So it was Anna's peer who went and became peer mentors to the kids at Harding High School. The district there didn't help us at all, or Johnson, but Dakota County did. So we just need to find out where they are. We can't sit around waiting for someone to come save us. These kids are graduating. By the time that, you know, everybody's talking about elementary, everybody loves an elementary school kid. Try and get into a high school kid. They have the world on their shoulder, and they're not all pretty. So I think we have to step up. It's a simple answer.
Step up.
And
I'd like to just mention that Robert, this really has been his baby, Almas, and you need a person like Robert. This is a really 24/7, 365 days a year role that goes well beyond what he's paid on a per hour basis, which would be pennies for a long time. So we need a person like Robert. My question, and thank you, Robert, we're so appreciative in so many ways. I have a question for you, Freddie. What more could we do in high schools to prepare students to make a career choice and have that desire really turn into action, and you really have the skills and the ability and the way to pay for college or whatever post-secondary plan, what more could we do?
I'd say, like, one of the better things that we could do to improve that topic is, like, have more events like the ones that Rob posted, and make it like a kind of a big deal. So like during, for example, in our district, during GoFo or like during homecoming week, have like a career expo kind of thing. That'd be kind of cool, because it would get the freshmen thinking more about career after college, I mean after high school and going into college, and it'd set their goals a lot more, because we had freshmen in Almas this year, and well, I was a junior last year, so there was an age difference, and I noticed it because I wasn't a freshman. So, and it really did change them, like, because I saw them, like, improve their grades and, like, kind of get on, like, the education and, like, just improve. They improved a lot. That's all I got to say.
Wow. Andy, the battery is gone, so go ahead and speak.
I just wanted to say, I have been coming to this now all 3 years. Robert, you are an inspiration. You are what's right about our education system. I think you are somebody who, what you're doing just You need more of it, obviously. And I also just, well, all I wanted to say was I want to thank everybody for coming today, and particularly Rick Aguilar for taking on this issue. Recognize Senator Chuck Weiger. I mean, he's here obviously as an elected official. He's taken an interest. I'm a little disappointed because I've been here in prior years. We had a lot more elected representatives and representatives of the public schools than we seem to have now for the third year. So I think our challenge is to make sure we get those people here because obviously, Robert, you are an example of leadership, and that's exactly what we lack in Minneapolis and St. Paul. And kudos to you.
Hi, I just have a couple comments. There are a lot of, and I want to address that at Hanford, Minneapolis, St. Paul. There are a lot of support programs that come and go and that have been around for a long time that are doing really, really excellent work. And I'm really glad to see that the programs in the outer ring suburbs are making some momentum. But my own opinion is, first of all, I support the outreach. I don't believe, fundamentally speaking, that that is the only problem with public education. But one thing that I would like to throw out there is, how do we coordinate so that the various support programs are having conversations across programs? My work in the education system, and I've been out for a while, was that it was a challenge getting programs to just talk among within a school. Seriously. Getting the administration to either support or to get the various programs to create the self-motivation to talk among one another to achieve the goal of, is every student being served? And to move away from this territorial, I think, self-serving, kind of like, and it's a natural progression because you feel lack of support, we got to take care of our own program and meet our own needs because we have to answer to our own reporting. So what can we do so that these support programs are talking within a schools, across districts, because they all have a lot of value. There isn't one model that is going to reach all students. So this model at Henry Sibley is really, really great, but it's not going to reach all students. I just recently experienced finding a particular charter school doing outreach differently than I, and I'm older, was conventionally raised to believe in. That is really, really like a narrow, isolated kind of go out and reach in the street, kind of like Mad Dad's, where you can hang on the corner. And my perception was less interest in utilizing the resources of the community as a vehicle for recruitment. So that was really interesting to me. But again, all of these things manifest over time because of experiences with lack of support, the challenge working across programs, across schools, across districts. And then last, I have a 19-year-old son. And we know that if a young person or anybody can follow a career and a passion that they have, they'll have greater life satisfaction. I know that. And I'd like him to get an education base that will like help him support himself, because that's the goal. Very gifted in math and science, and he's following the social justice path, which is great and going. Great, my son, but could you use that gift in math and science as a backup? And so we have to help our young people balance, because I tell all young people, how are you going to make a contribution beyond yourself? How are you going to look beyond yourself to make sure that you've made this world a better place for others? It's not just about them.
I just have one quick thing. There is actually an organization, to give them a little plug, it's called the Mission Impact Council, who's doing exactly what you were talking about, because they realize that there are all these incredible things going around the cities in different schools and programs, and there's all these organizations that really want to help. And so this organization called Mission Impact Council, what they're doing is trying to gather all these people together for some sort of shared project, or maybe document, so that give to every district, so here are the resources out there to help you. And it's a really cool organization. Ramon Pastrano IV is one of those from Impact Lives. It's a really cool deal. Maya Santa Maria, with her program on 1400 La Raza every Saturday, is bringing these organizations to the radio so that parents can hear, oh, I didn't know that organization existed that can help my kid. You know, and it's all fairly new, and everybody's creating these things, but the need is there, just like you just said. And so that's what's really cool right now. At least things are starting to happen. And so to answer that question, at least it's starting.
I just want to raise an issue here about the Minneapolis public schools, because if Minneapolis public schools are going to start shipping teachers from overseas, Spain or Mexico, it's not going to work, because most of the teachers from Mexico or Spain, they have a different culture, they have different values. They don't really know the students' needs in this country. So, because they don't know what's going on with the school, with the students' needs in this country, then I don't think that they are going to be effective teachers. So, the Minneapolis public schools, they need to start looking, you know, into hiring more teachers from local, not at international, the national level.
I know Elliot is about to respond, but just to think, if we have all of our districts with a 90% graduation of Latinos, how much you want to bet that some of those kids will choose education? And so I think that can change just with locally grown. It's going to take a little while, but in response.
No, Minneapolis public school, I think they're 4 years and a half, and we stopped doing that. Now we're doing the grow your own. We're looking at the own people that we have to grow your own teachers. So, yeah. And you're right.
Well, have a round of applause for those awesome people that are on the stage. In regards to anything, it's really the kids that have made the big difference at my school, at Sibley in our district. By giving them a voice within doing what we're doing, doing the community service and things like that, giving them that voice, they're the ones that changed the environment of my school. And that's why we have a 90% graduation rate. That's why we have Latinos in every single activity in the school. Because those initial kids fought for it. They fought against this change. And now kids like Freddie, he's on the football team.
Right, you know, so
it's them. You know, we just give them that voice and they run. So that's all the kids at Sibley and adults that give them that support.
I'm going to hand her a broad hand to me. You know, over the years, I don't know, maybe it's 15 years, when we've been working in this achievement gap issue, I always fall back to working with Rob Hansen and Carmen Robles. And you know why? You know, they've had such a successful program. It didn't happen overnight, but it's really a prototype of programs we need throughout the school districts. Now, we're never going to have these programs everywhere. There is no program you're going to have in every school. There is no, you know, there's not a lot of Rob Hansons out there, I got to tell you. Okay? I'm sorry to tell you. You're not going to duplicate these programs. But, you know, we're going to have to start doing, and we all know this, you know, we got to, bit by bit, we got to have to start having more success. We're not going to educate everybody next year. The achievement gap's not going to go away. You know, Chuck, you're going to be retired. I'll be gone somewhere, smoking a cigar. But, you know, the achievement gap's going to be here. It's not going to go away, folks. I hate to tell you, overnight, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen in Minnesota. It's not going to happen nationally. So, but we have to start with some success stories. We have to start with some collaborations that we don't have now, that we have to start putting together, and we can do it, and you're wonderful. You were here all morning, and we're thinking thoughts now of having a larger Latino Achievement Gap Summit. I'm thinking yet this year. We've got to start implementing some programs. We have to start implementing, and we have to form some collaborations. So these are the type of meetings I've been inspired by, because we have people of every stripe coming together and talking candidly about this issue. And this issue is a crisis. I put it in the crisis category when we're losing kids that their futures look very bleak, very realistic. This is not pretending it's going to happen. It's going to happen. So thank you, Rob, the guys, Pedro, God bless you. I know Pedro, thank you. Foster, Freddie, you're our future, baby. You got to make it happen now. We're going to track Freddie. And we want reports on Freddie, Rob. Where's Freddie? Remember that game? Where's Freddie?
Where's
game like that?
Thank you, Rick.
Oh, well, yeah. No, thank you. So here's what's going to happen. We're all going to go and stop over at La Familia, say hi to all the booths over there. Then at 12:30, we're going to have our awards presentations, our Hispanic, La Familia Hispanic Heritage Awards. And one of our recipients, Cecilia, is going to be getting something because for all her work. But there's going to be other folks from the community there. And stop over and say hi. Thank you, SPNN. Thank you for being with us. I think you captured some very candid, real conversations here. And we'll be seeing the video on this after we do a little splicing and dicing. But do some Photoshop and Rick Aguilar, of course. But then we're going to come back with that. And then La Raza Radio with the program Graduating Latinos. They're on every Saturday for an hour. So thank you for La Raza Radio. They were broadcasting live across the hall for sound purposes. But thank you, and thank you, everybody. And let's go visit La Familia. And we'll keep everyone in contact here. Okay? Thank you. Thank you very much.